Drug dealer Benzes with gold diggers in them. And elevator condos on everything I love. This ain't a wave or a phase, cause all that shit fades. This lifestyle's forever when you made. They tweet about the length I made them wait. What the fuck you expect when a nigga got a cape and he's great? Ovens full of cakes that he bakes, steel spread and paste. The love just accentuates the hate. This is for my bodybuilding clients moving weight. Just add water, stir it like a shake. Play amongst the stars like the roof in the Wraith. Get the table next to mine, make our bottle servers race. These are the games we play, we are the names they say. This is the drug money your ex-nigga claim he makes to all of my young niggas. I am your ghost in your raid. This is my purple tape, save up for rainy days and baby mama wishes. Along with the side bitches, they try to coexist, end up wishing you die bitches. Stood on every couch in the A at the black party. No jewelry on, but you richer than everybody, you laugh a little louder. The DJ say your name a little prouder. And we don't need a globe to show you the world is ours.
I don't know, man. I don't know, man. He talk a lot of he's very flamboyant with his, you know. And I don't know if you guys know who that is. That's young Pusha Terrence, Pusha T.
If you know, you know.
And like, he's like 5'6", maybe 5'8". He's a very small individual.
Most rappers are short.
Yeah, and
Check me out.
Okay.
Check me out.
I'm checking you out.
Check me out.
Check you out.
The show don't start till you do the gunshots.
Oh, that's how I go. Bada bow. I got new gunshots now. Boom, boom, pow. Boom, pow.
Actually,
pow. Brrr, boom. That's bang. There we go. Bang. Add it, you know. You
welcome everybody to H Town's Finest. Hey, your podcaster's favorite podcast.
Your podcaster's favorite.
He from the tray, I'm from the clock. H Town Stand Up, 16 Shots Podcast with Young James, Boogie Bin Laden, and AR Dub. Episode 26.
26, damn.
Man, I'm feeling spicy. That's why I started out with Pusha Terrence.
Okay, you got some beef in you? You got beef because he's known for his beefs.
Hey, man. I'm spicy tonight. You know what I'm talking about?
All right. Well, what's on your mind, man?
Oh, nothing at all. What you got? I saw the itinerary. You shot it out.
Yeah.
I saw some things on there. Let me check it out. Let me see. We talked about what we were going to talk about last week. Let me see. Okay. Introduction did that. Oh,
yeah.
Oh, hold on. Let me see.
Okay.
Hold on.
Professional.
All right. I'm going to go off script.
All right.
Not even 5 minutes. Bro.
Off script.
Two things. Our gas line, our major gas pipeline from the south to the east coast, gotta have better security where the Russian hackers can't hack into it, man.
True. Shots fired.
Who was the employee that was looking at Pornhub on their work computer and got the spyware put on there, bro? They gotta get fired.
Rice to work for HISD.
Uh-huh.
And I worked in the business services, FMO, business services, whatever.
You was looking at Pornhub on your computer?
Let me get there. And I'm gonna take you to Georgia, drive around to Florida, come up through Mississippi, Alabama, all that. I'm gonna hop over Texas, go to California, go up the coast, Washington, jump into Canada, and then fly straight back down to where we at. I'm gonna get there. What I'm trying to say, it's a journey.
You missed your calling. You definitely should be a preacher.
You know what I'm saying? I used to work for Houston Independent School District, and I used to be in the FMO business services, and we used to watch all the alarm systems. And you know, we used to watch the alarm systems, right? Mm-hmm. And so basically we sat in a room, and if alarm went off somewhere at the school, like, you know, it'd be like, you know, cafeteria alarm,
right?
We would look at it, we would call, you know, the school head custodian, and he'll be like, oh man, they got rats over there, it's probably a dog or, you know, whatever. Went off more than three, if the motion center went off more than four or five times, called HISDPD. They go up to check it out. You know what I'm saying? Right. So a lot of times you're just sitting there doing nothing. So this is when Napster first hit. You know what I'm saying? This is when the Blue Cord, you know, first got popular. So, man, I went to downloading. You know what I'm saying? I'm downloading. Then I started with music, of course, you know, keeping it clean. You know, I'm gonna get every song I ever wanted. And I was like, oh, let me get some movies. I can get movies. Okay, let me get some movies. And then I saw them three letters pop across the screen. You know what I'm saying? XXX.
Oh, you had to hit download.
I was like, oh, hold up. I can just, you know, get Pinky's Greatest Hits, man. You know what I'm saying? And so I come back to work one day, and, you know, the security thing or the alarm, that's third shift. Mm-hmm. So I come in at like 8 and leave at like 5, you know what I mean? So somehow somebody got into my computer, mm-hmm, and was looking at it, but they didn't tell me. I just come back and look, and I'm like, man, I wasn't watching this, man. You know what I'm saying? And so that's when I stopped getting on the porn at work. I was like, man, you know, I don't be walking in here and somebody looking at my face like I was, you know, looking at, you know.
You definitely was looking at Pinky on the
clock. Art of Zoo. Do not, I'm telling you now, do not Google Art of Zoo. Don't do it.
Art of Zoo?
Don't do it.
I'm definitely going to Google.
Do not do it. I'm telling you, don't do it.
You can't bring up,
bruh,
your XXX downloads. Bring up Art of Zoo.
Do not.
And then expect people not to go look up Art of Zoo.
Whatever you do in life, if you don't do nothing else, do not go to art. I'm not being funny right now.
While you're looking up Art of Zoo.
No, I'm not. I'm trying to get the ding. But do not, whatever you do, do not go look up Art of Zoo.
Look, man, I'm just saying.
Somebody got me on accident. Like, I had the same thing. Like, oh, man, what am I going to go look? I wish I wouldn't have looked at it.
All I'm going to say is, whoever that employee was that downloaded that porn at work, they got the whole East Coast fucked off with the gas.
Mm-hmm.
Man, they trash. But then it's supposed to be a Russian hacker is what I was reading today. And apparently the gas company based out of Houston,
yeah,
paid the ransom. I guess they paid the ransom. I saw Joe Biden talking too.
Yeah.
It's like a private company. And I'm sitting here like, time out. A major gas pipeline for America's economy doesn't have like U.S. government federal grade security for their shit?
That is fuck messed up, man.
What?
That's messed up. So, I mean, are the Russians that good? Because it's all, they always hacking something, man.
Always, man.
Are they that much better than us at hacking?
I don't know, but I was listening to, I got it to, I don't want to tell everybody what I do, but let's just say I was in a situation where I got in somebody's car and they were listening to like that liberal radio.
Or NPR?
Something like that.
Or are you talking about?
Nah, it was like the liberal.
Oh, media. You're talking about 690.
Something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, six.
The channel
640.
Yeah, and they was in there and they were like, well, you know, Putin had something to do with it, because if they didn't, then, you know, they would have got shot in the face.
Yeah.
So
the Russians, man, shout out to the Russians, man. Y'all some cold babushkas, man.
So I brought that up just to say, anything that important should have federal U.S. government grade encryption on all their networking needs. One person shouldn't be able to download Bang Brothers at work and then open up the floodgates for the Russian hackers to fuck up the East Coast. And now people going out here like gas gourd. That's the other thing, man. When something happens, you don't have to go out and fill up every tank of your car plus 5 tanks of gas.
Yeah.
You ain't got to do that, bro. Just, you know, get a tank of gas. You know what I'm saying? The same thing with like the ammo. Like, just because we're going on lockdown for COVID doesn't mean you got to go buy up all the guns and ammo or all the toilet tissue. To this day, I still don't understand why people went up and bought all the toilet tissue.
I mean, mud ass is like probably one of the worst things you can have.
But all the toilet tissue though?
But I'm just saying, like, if you think about the worst thing that can happen.
Who said go buy all the, when the COVID lockdown shit happened.
Yeah.
You go to HEB, all the shit was gone that you probably don't need to be using if you want to make sure you got a healthy immune system. Like all the processed meats, all the snacks, all the cookies and shit, toilet tissue, beer and wine, fruits and veggies was there.
I'm just saying, man, like, if it's one thing I don't want to happen anytime, it's a swampy mud ass.
But you gotta know, bro, you ain't got a hoard toilet tissue.
Maybe that's, I mean, okay, I'm gonna tell you a secret, bro. I've been revealing this to people, you know, like in pieces, but I'm gonna let the world know. My go-to, if I don't want to do something, man, is it gave me the runs. If I don't want to do something, I just tell them, I'm like, hey, it gave me the runs. And that silences anything, man. Nobody's gonna say like, oh man, what? No, man, take it anyway. They're gonna be like, ooh, okay. I don't wanna go outside. Oh man, I got the runs. Oh, okay, I'm sorry, man. I don't wanna eat the food. Man, it gives me the runs. Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
I get it. You lie about having diarrhea.
I'm just saying.
Explain to me how the lie about diarrhea. You know what?
I know. I'm gonna tell you because
we're gonna be here all night.
No, I'm just going to what you're saying about toilet paper, man. Like having nothing to wipe your backside. Okay, I'm gonna cuss for this next episode, but after this episode, I ain't cussing no more again. All right, like so, having your ass not be able to be taken care of properly is high priority in life, and obviously it is because when the world's from the end, the first thing people did was take all the toilet paper.
Gotcha. Topic one.
Summertime.
That's not topic one.
Oh, we're talking about Dr. Umar and Dr. Kevin.
Whoa. This Kevin Samuels character is a doctor?
Yeah, I believe he's a doctor.
All right, so do you know exactly what the beef is about?
Okay.
Tell us what the beef is about.
So Dr. Umar, this esteemed...
The Prince of Pan African.
Yeah.
Where are my donations?
He decided that he would make a point to say that he didn't like that Kevin Samuels was degrading and putting down our queens. And so Kevin Samuels is like, hold up, man. You know, I ain't got nothing against the brother, but where is my donations? You know, so they're having a semi-intellectual, passive-aggressive beef with each other, which is hilarious to see.
It is hilarious.
Two 50-year-old men who really ain't did nothing but stir up stuff with each other.
All right, so I've heard Umar Johnson, Dr. Umar Johnson. I've heard him over the span of some years. Mm-hmm. Homie be spewing some truth sometimes. And then homie be tripping too. Like I feel him on that. Like he been building a school for 10 years.
Maybe 15.
And then I just heard him on the Breakfast Club say, my brothers, I'm about a month away from opening. If I can get some plumbers and some electricians. And it sounds like my guy, you got a building still that needs infrastructure work, but whatever.
Well, speaking of what you're saying, we talked about this earlier. Like a lot of times we have ideas and, you know, this is going to go across the board when it comes to people in general, but just people have ideas and people feel like, because I have idea, then I should be the end all be all, or I should like, it's collaboration and there's pieces. Like me personally, JB, I'm good at certain things. I might have a great idea, but I know I need person A, person B, person C to actualize it. And I don't need to be over person A, person. I need person A, person B, person C to have their greatest input into it. Not they do what I say. I tell them the idea and they put their greatest into it. And it's obvious, it's very glaring that what he did, he had a great idea, but he ain't had the actualizations. Like, I need to know some plumbers. I need to know some architects. I need to know some people who are experts. The idea is great, but the actualization takes specialists. And we don't really, in the culture, you know, I'm all over the place.
You are, because we ain't talking about that. And I think Umar Johnson full of shit.
Well, I'm going to say, because this is the same thing with the who writes their own rhymes, who doesn't. Like, it's in the grand scheme, what do we care about the end product? Why do we care about if just Drake wrote it?
Or no, just, stop. Uh-oh. You getting off topic. Okay. We talking about Dr. Umar Johnson and Kevin Samuels.
It all goes together, bro.
It do, because the Umar Johnson full of shit. You know what I'm saying? Because he been building the same school for 10 plus. And it start. I feel like he started out with like a bare bones building. And next thing I know, he's like, I got two state-of-the-art buildings I just bought for X amount of dollars.
That's what I'm saying. You're right. I'm saying, like, I can go out tomorrow. Let's say I get blessed with $2 billion. I can go out and buy a building. But me knowing the operations of the building, that don't come with money. You know what I'm saying? You need experts, and you need, when I say experts, I mean people who will have knowledge on situations to actualize your thoughts and your dreams, or else you going to be
ass. But see, when it comes to Dr. Umar Johnson, I feel like he full of shit, bro, because I've seen people do more with less. Like, I don't have to go out and get this brand new state-of-the-art building if I want to open up a school for my community. Like, I can find a building that's up and running, mm-hmm. my guy, and I can go from there. But that's either here nor there. Mm. The problem, we talking about the beef they got, you know what I'm saying? They're both YouTubers. I feel like they're both YouTube sensations. I feel like it's clickbait, man. But I did a little deep dive in this Kevin Samuels today.
Okay.
While I was at work.
All right.
Found out two things.
Two things.
Some female hurt him.
You think so?
Some female hurt him. And secondly, it's a lot of niggas who really fuck with Kevin Samuels. Like, dude walked by my desk and, you know, he glanced at my phone and was like, "Hey, you listen to him?"
Yeah.
And it sparked up a whole conversation about how, like, hey, man, I really feel what he be saying. He be telling the truth, man. These females, this, that, and the third, man.
I'm not.
And they really, like, bro. He's a role model for some of these niggas.
I'm going to play both sides of the field. But I'm going to say that Kevin Samuels says some real things.
He does.
He says some real things. And what it is like, what I think that, not to cut you off, but I think that what we deal with in male and female relations nowadays is so polarizing. Like, it's either you're feminist or you're chauvinist. Mm-hmm. And there's so much space in between that. And so, like, his perspective is sometimes is like, hold up, bro. Hold up, female. You have all these strikes against your character, but you want to be treated as if you have no strikes, which is respectable. But in the same breath, if you don't get what you're desiring, this is why.
I think his biggest point he tried to drive across to some of these females are, you are expecting X from a man.
Yeah.
But you don't have anything comparable to offer.
Exactly.
And when I say that, you got to be offering more than just sex.
Yeah.
And your body. It got to be some other shit.
Yeah.
You can't be somebody, female or male, bro. You can't, like, want someone who, I can't say, hey, I deserve a six-figure woman who gonna take care of me. I sit at the house and I don't have nothing to offer. Nothing at all. Buy me J's all day. With that, yeah, you gotta bring something to the table too.
Well, what I was gonna say is that our society has, and this is white, black, you know, across the board, has cultivated the mindset that women should, not women, women and men have gender roles. And so if I say I have a gender role, if I believe in gender roles, that women do this and men do that, and I say that, well, if I'm a woman, I do this, I homemake. Not saying that that's what women should do. I'm just saying if I agree to that.
You're going
to
get in trouble, bro.
No, but I'm saying if a woman agrees to be, well, I want to be a homemaker, a child bearer, and child raiser, and the man's going to be the breadwinner and the protector, right? So what you're bringing to the table is the things that you're good at. Cooking, cleaning.
Yeah, but some of them ain't doing that, though. Some of them don't want to bring that to the table. Some of them think pussy is all they need to bring to the table.
But,
and with that being said, that's why Kevin Samuels has a platform. Are you booing me?
No, I'm booing that thought.
You booing that thought?
Not that you said it. I'm just saying that they think that.
Talk about. That's the thing. Okay.
I'm booing that somebody think that all I have to do, man or female, that all them bringing sex to the table is, yeah, my sex makes shit go, you know.
A lot of them feel like that's all I got to do. And so that's why Kevin Samuels has a platform, because he's speaking on stuff that a lot of men feel like he should be saying. I just feel like his interview platform, it got to be staged, because some of these females he's talking to, man, they dumb as a box of rocks, bro. Like, that cannot be just random call-ins.
Do you think he has even if he has a betting system betting with a B.
It sounded like you said bet. Like,
I was swallowing. I was swallowing some
pause,
water.
Pause, and pause, bro.
So, but he has.
And I don't think vetting is a dingable.
How many times that? So you telling me when you're in a regular day and you like talking to your coworker, you're like, yeah, man, I was just vetting all these. No, man, that is a word that you use only in certain situations.
We use that probably once a day, maybe twice.
Once a day.
In my line of work.
Okay.
Nigga, how you going to finish this?
Okay. So.
Like, this nigga be with me.
I believe you. I'm just saying.
You got a new soundboard.
Yeah, I got a working soundboard. It's been no gapples. Okay. So, I think that, man. Okay. So when we first started this podcast, I remember the first three episodes, I said that niggas is stupid. I said that like three pods in a row, right?
Yeah, and then somebody called you a coon and a bootlicker, so you stopped saying it.
Yeah, but I still think that I was right. I wasn't right. I was correct when I was saying it, but I'm going to say it again. Like, man, it takes all kinds to make the world go around. And if you think that it's not women or men that think in those ridiculous ways, he's just... The woman who's calling his show for advice is dumb off top.
At this point.
In the beginning.
At this point, that you know what you're getting.
Yeah.
So when you call in or join his live, you already know what's finna happen. Yeah. Like, homie's been, he was on Adam No Jumper, bro. He was on Adam 22. What the fuck Kevin Samuels on No Jumper for? That's what I'm saying. At this point, it's just
I got an issue with Adam 22.
We can get into that in a minute, okay. But it's just, at this point, it's like clickbait. It's like, it's his marketing rollout. Because apparently you can actually like have a private session with homie.
Yeah.
If you pay. He's like an image consultant or something.
I mean, that was his job. He's a marketing.
So, and I get it. So he probably can help you get that, what is he calling it?
Trophy.
He's helping you be a trophy wife, get a high value man, or some shit like that. I just think it's funny that Dr. Umar Johnson and Kevin Samuels are beefing, and hopefully these guys can have a live one on one. I would love to see that.
I think so. I'm gonna go to Cassidy.
Why are you going to Cassidy?
Because Cassidy wants to create a show where. Cassidy.
I don't want you to lose your thought process. No, I'm was finna slander Adam 22, and I was waiting for it.
I'm not slandering him. I just think that he's a nerd. He's just tattooed, but he's a nerd.
What's that got to do with his platform?
Because like, I'm a nerd somewhat, but I'm also a jock in some ways, and so, you know, those cultures collide sometimes, right? And there's certain things a nerd can say to a jock that like a jock can't do nothing but like respect nerd. Like, you didn't work hard to get these grades, you know, whatever. And the jock is like, nah, I didn't. You know what I'm saying? I can kick a football, throw a football, tackle. I can do these things. So I didn't work hard. I didn't have to work too hard to get some of these grades. And a jock can say, well, you ain't do X, Y, Z. You know what I'm saying? You ain't sacrificed going out or to go work out to be able to perform. And he's like, nah, I can still have a regular quote unquote high school experience, right? So all that being said,
that's not true.
Huh? What you mean that's not true?
I feel like both people have to work at their craft. So while the athlete is in the gym, the quote unquote nerd is studying. So they both have the same sacrifices, just in different fields.
No,
what you mean though?
Because when the nerd sacrifices studying, you had to study anyway.
What do you mean?
Like if I'm an athlete and I have a test.
If you're an athlete, you got to work out anyway.
Yeah, but it's physically exhausting. Me reading a book is like, yes, it's mentally exhausting, but I'm not hurting. My body's not hurting from reading a book.
You're still sacrificing something. You're sacrificing partying, having a good time to work on your craft. The nerd is sacrificing that to learn calculus or geometry or trigonometry. The jock is sacrificing that to work on his jump shot or be in the weight room. They're both sacrifices. You're spending time on your craft.
I would say,
you can't say one sacrifice is greater than the other.
I would say that the quote unquote nerd, their sacrifice is less because if I'm doing calculus, right, I'm not learning calculus in the 10th grade. If I'm a nerd, I've already got calculus by the 10th grade. So there's a lot of instances where I'm not learning. I already know this. Like high school is not hard. Like even for a jock, it's not hard. A lot of times, like I ain't do the work. You know what I'm saying? So if I'm a quote unquote nerd, I'm doing the extra stuff because I enjoy it or I like it. I'm not necessarily sacrificing. Like who sacrifices more as far as, you know, time and effort, I would say the jock, because the jock has to do everything the nerd does plus go strain their body out. Whereas the nerd doesn't have to, like he has to go to class, he has to study, but he don't have to also, you know, dodge 300 pound linemen or try to, you know, block shots or, you know, hit baseballs and have a physical weight on his shoulders.
That's not true. Because the nerd has sacrificed even that experience where I'm not playing the sport because I want to focus solely on my grades or this craft that I'm doing. The jock sacrificed not really going as far as they can with their education because I want to focus on my craft on the field or the court.
But
the nerd still has to go to gym class. The nerd still has to get some sort of exercise, just like the jock
really
has.
Doesn't.
Okay, but you're not finna say that one sacrifice is greater than the other.
I'm saying
just
that
because
it's
one guy is a nerd and is studying.
Yeah.
No, you said that the jocks is greater.
Yeah, it is.
You didn't say it was different. You said greater.
It's greater.
Not greater. You can't say one sacrifice is greater than the other.
Okay.
Because you don't know what that person is sacrificing or giving up.
Are we talking about individual? Are we talking about blanket?
You can't blanket it. Everyone's sacrifice generally, is different. Everyone's sacrifice is different.
In general, I think that dolphins.
Okay.
I'm just saying, you can generalize. Or in general, quote unquote nerds are not sacrificing because what I'm saying is that everything the nerd has to do as far as schoolwork, the jock has to do too, right? Yes or no?
That's not the case.
I'm saying
because we know a lot of jocks that don't even do the work.
But
they just get the passing grade. They don't even do the work.
Yeah, but they still have to come to class, right?
Not all of them. Hell, I ain't go to class half time.
You know what I'm saying?
I wasn't even that great of a jock.
You know what I'm saying? But you can't
say one sacrifice.
I'm trying to be politically correct.
And I'm trying to figure out what does that have to do with Adam 22 and why are you saying Adam 22 is
because he's a nerd.
Does that have to do with anything?
And so I feel like sometimes when me and you were talking about athletics, you can respect my opinion, I can respect yours because I know that you went out there and did that. You had experience with it, right?
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
What's the difference between Adam 22, Stephen A. Smith, Skip Bayless?
Nothing.
So you're saying that Adam 22, Stephen A. and Skip Bayless are in the same conversation?
Yep.
And your conversation is saying, or your take is saying, they shouldn't have an opinion on sports because they never played it.
No, my opinion is saying that them being the barometer of how sports commentary is taken is kind of off, because at the end of the day, they, their opinion is respected. And I like some of Adam 22 takes. I like some of Stephen A. I like some of Skip Bayless's. But when Shannon Sharp talks, when Max Kellerman talks, when these former athletes or people who are high level athletes talk, Ryan Clark, when they talk, I'm listening differently, because not only are they saying it from their analytical position, but they're analytical position, but they're also saying it from their perspective of, like, I've been out there, bro. I had to go up against, you know, Randy Moss, Chris Carter, some of these great wide receivers. If I'm Ryan Clark, if I'm Max Kellerman, I used to box for real. You know what I'm saying? I got a hip hop album. I used to rap. So when I'm talking about hip hop, I'm not saying it with the ear of a listener. I'm saying it from the ear of a listener and a participant. So I have a greater, a bigger pool of knowledge to, or understanding to pull from than Stephen. Like, Stephen A didn't play in college, did he?
Oh, I don't know.
I don't think so. I think he got hurt or something. He didn't play. And then, like, he could have been, would have been. You know what I'm saying? I could have been, would have been. So why is your opinion better than mine? Because you could have been, would have been. I respect his years of journalism. I respect what he put in. But, like, him being the barometer of what is right and what's wrong, it's like Mel Kiper Jr. Like, why is his opinion so, like, you get it wrong every year, bro? But it's like, man, them dudes, man, we are fooled by their charisma.
So let me ask you a question.
What's that?
Do you think Adam 22 is a culture vulture? Because to be honest with you, he has more hip-hop takes and interviews than sports.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think he should be able to have the voice he has within hip-hop, and he's not a real participant of hip-hop?
I think his opinion is valid. His opinion, he can have his opinion, but when there's a bunch of situations that come, when, like, when the shit hit the fan and it gets real, he gonna do nerdy, non-jock, non-hip-hop type shit. Like, look, the game not gonna have a conversation about the time somebody slapped him. Ice Cube not gonna have a conversation about the time somebody slapped him. Scarface ain't gonna have a conversation about the time somebody slapped him. Adam 22, oh yeah, that time that, I was at some kind of festival and MGK slapped me. Like, bro, he slapped you because you stepped over your boundaries. Whatever, like, you're a nerd, you're a reporter, and you got tattoos and you understand the culture to an extent, but at the end of the day, you're not with this. And so I can always come smack shit out of you.
He got smacked by Machine Gun Kelly though.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Not even, like, come on, man. I respect his opinion and I respect his, but I'm just like, bro, that's not the comment. There's so many ways I want to say it that are not PC.
Oh, well, I mean, you can say the non-PC shit.
I'm
just say what you want to say.
I'm just saying, like, he's a
don't
nerd.
Don't dance around him. Just say what the fuck you want to say.
He's a nerd, bro.
So you're saying the white boy shouldn't have opinions on black people's culture?
That's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying that he's a nerd, bro. He's a nerd. He's like Vlad, man.
Oh, Vlad the feds.
No, Vlad is a nerd, man.
Nah, you stupid if you keep going on Vlad telling you business.
Vlad is a nerd, bro. He's infatuated with hip-hop culture, man. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Are.
Yeah. And so, but when your infatuation turns into something else, when you, like, you just like.
So let me ask you a question.
You sensationalize shit that you shouldn't. You're a nerd. You ain't never been in a gunfight.
But let me ask you a question. So who do you blame? Do you blame the Adam 22s and the Vlads?
Mm-hmm.
Or do you blame the participants of the culture who keep going on their platforms?
There's no blame to be dealt out.
Nah, a little bit, because it sounds like, in a sense, it kind of sounds like you're saying their platform necessarily ain't needed.
I feel like you're trying to turn me up, bro.
No, I'm just saying, it sounds like you're saying that their platform ain't needed.
I'm not trying.
It goes back to the conversation we had, not to bring up old shit, about the stupid rule that you said, the charging rule in basketball.
Yeah, which is dumbass rule.
Is it actually the rule, or is it the interpretation and the gray area that people use, that the players are using to use it? So is it Adam 22 and Vlad, are they the problem?
Yes.
Or is it the participants of hip-hop who keep going there on their platforms using them as a voice?
Okay, so for clarity, there's no problem with Adam 22 or Vlad. But the issue is, for me, it's like, if you have not, hip-hop, our music is our intellectual property, right? In 2021, 1999,
right,
85, from 85 to 2021, we've been able to use our experience, our culture, the way we walk, talk, the way we realize, the way we actualize in the world as something that we can use to monetize and to live. We've created culture, we've created industry, right? Adam 22 didn't grow up in that. He didn't come from that. Stephen A. Smith grew up in the hip-hop culture, but Stephen A. Smith, he not built like Jalen Rose.
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you know for a fact that Adam 22 didn't grow up engulfed in hip-hop culture?
I know he didn't.
No, do you know that for a fact?
Well, I'm saying, if he did, then he wouldn't be talking about him getting smacked by MGK.
Well, everybody is not that hard and have...
It's not about being hard.
Nah, Game ain't finna tell you who smacked him. The Game will tell you who he smacked.
I think Game's been smacked before, right?
Everybody probably have.
Yeah, but I'm saying that in the way that MGK approached Adam 22, mm-hmm, he wouldn't approach anybody who is of the culture, who is of the culture, not in the culture, but of the culture like that.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
You think, would you consider Pharrell being of the culture?
Yes.
Pharrell told you straight up, don't come fuck with me, I call the police. I got the feds on speed dial. That's what Pharrell said.
Yeah, because Pharrell is worth an amount that I shouldn't be doing this dumb shit. I've started out down here in the trenches, and I'm now at this point, like, I'm OG status, man. Yeah, I'm calling the feds.
But that's frowned upon in our hip hop culture, though.
I don't give a damn about that part.
Well, hold on. So why do you give a damn about Adam 22 then?
Because
why do you give a damn about Adam 22 being vulnerable enough to be like, yeah, MJK, Machine Gun Kelly smacked me?
No, he wasn't vulnerable. Adam 22, he was complacent, and that's not part of our. That's not how we get down. Everybody's lost a fight. Everybody.
But you, just, so you've got on your platform and talked about getting two-piece, no front, no shit.
I've never got two-piece.
Uh-huh.
I got stole on.
Same thing. Stole on, smacked, same thing.
Yeah, but all I'm saying is, when I talk...
A nigga dick beat has got put on your face.
So, what I'm saying is, talking about it, saying that this thing happened is one thing. The way it happened with the lead up is like, it was some stuff that happened that, you know, it was consequent. It was all type of shit that happened before that, right? Adam 22 was like, he don't like me. I don't know why he don't like me. I saw him and then he smacked me and I was like, what? Whoa. You know, like, nah, man, you nerdy. And nothing wrong with being nerdy, man, but you nerdy in a non-nerdy culture. Not saying it's right or wrong. I'm just saying that that's like me being a chauvinist in a feminist house. It's not that the way I feel, the way I react and feel is not accepted in this setting.
Well, if I go by the take you just gave, Adam 22 has no business being in our culture. So he just needs to stick to interviewing skateboarders and stoners.
I'm not saying that particular. I'm just saying.
No, but that's what you're saying.
No, I'm saying that. Adam 22 is, and let me add on to it. It's not just him. Academics is the same to me. Him and Academics are the same. And Academics is black. What I'm saying is that if you're of the culture and you understand the culture, it's certain questions, a certain situation that you won't be in. Me and you have been in 100 situations. You ain't never seen somebody come up to me and be like, oh, fuck you, you old hoe ass nigga. Mm-hmm. You ain't never seen nobody, even when we was out of bounds, even when we was in places where people didn't know us, had never seen us before, you ain't never seen nobody approach us in approach me or you in a disrespectful manner.
Yeah, but part of that is because, you know, we're not pulling the antics that academics is pulling.
And that's what I'm saying. But the antics come from not understanding your situation, not understanding the culture. I'm a poor antics.
Academics fully understands the culture. He just chooses to go left.
You think so? Because,
yeah, I know so.
He's a
I know so.
He's a BAN, man.
What's a BAN?
A bitch ass nigga, man.
Yeah, but see, academics, it gets them paid though. It's shock value. See, you know what I'm saying? Like this whole clout shit, that's a real thing. And people be knowing better. But they like the clout. It gets them famous or whatever they want to do. That's how academics pays the bills, bro. Academics don't pay the bills asking regular questions like a Mano or Wayno. Is that the boy name? Wayno?
Yeah,
like Wayno. Even Joe. Even when Joe was on Everyday Struggle, and even now, Joe was of the culture. So when Joe go on a rant,
yeah,
it's the reason why he going on a rant. He's been a rapper. So when he be talking to Lil Yachty about, you know, hey man, you don't know or Blueface about, you don't know what's up with your deal.
Sir,
it's because he's from the culture.
That's what I'm saying.
But academics know better.
He
know better. Academics knows better, bro. He just chooses to go left. He chooses to get on Twitch.
You know why?
And drink Hennessy and talk shit.
You know why?
Knowing damn well that he can't do shit if Meek Mill run upon him.
You know why?
Because these new niggas get this is what these new niggas do.
Because, know why?
They've never had to face real repercussions.
You know why?
They ain't grew up in a non-Instagram life.
You know why?
Well, talking that bullshit would get you ran up on the shot.
Ran up on or shot. I'm saying that growing up in the culture, you knew that your words had repercussions. Your actions had repercussions, right? So I can't go around and be saying F this person, F that person, because I might see that person and now I got to deal with that person.
We made a song and said, fuck the hooker. And after we made the song and said, fuck hooker.
We went on tour.
We was ready to run up on Kiyadi or whoever we had issue with.
But that's because we are of the culture.
These new niggas, they say that shit for shock value. He was running around with 6ix9ine.
Who? Academics?
Yeah. He was in a pool with 6ix9ine, bro.
I mean,
me and you have never just been inside a swimming pool just together without trying to fuck with females. We ain't just been on vacation together in a fucking pool.
No.
With floaties on, my nigga.
No, think about the...
you know what I'm saying?
No, think about the... Like, I don't have any pictures. I don't have a bunch of pictures. We need to take more pictures. Not... Like, I have one picture of me and you when we was in Austin, right? Mm-hmm. I got a picture... Like, I don't have a bunch of pictures of me and the people that I care for. Just, you know...
You know what? I got about... 3 or 4 disposable cameras.
What?
I'm afraid to get them developed.
Hey, man, give them to me. I'll develop them tonight.
I know you will, and that's the problem.
What's on them, man?
I don't know.
This plan, look, man.
Man, I don't know.
Look, man.
At this point in my life, I don't need ghosts from my past hunting me, okay?
You said ghosts from the past, man. Shit,
man. With that being said, Adam22 and Vlad, they need to go find another lane. But, you know.
Fucking both, man.
I do like Adam22 little setup though. With that being said, you know, we'll talk about that next part.
Okay, great.
Let's go. What you got for what's next on the docket? Because I like the little outline you do, you know what I'm saying? I don't want your work to be in vain.
Okay. Summertime, summertime. Ooh, summertime.
I found out hurricane season got pushed up a month.
Pushed forward or backwards?
Like forward. Like it's gonna come sooner than later. Like next month.
That makes sense.
Why? Because the nigga who run the weather machine said, let's make it flood?
No, because...
We do a flood, too.
No, but what I'm saying is because you don't have some of the factors like air travel. Like, it's a bunch of natural factors that would subside or that would concede or subside. I don't know if that's right. But
oh, your little listener, she'll correct you.
Yeah, she will. She will. She will.
I don't know if I was supposed to say it's she.
It's a she, man. Her name is...
I'm
going to say a name.
Don't say a name, nigga. You ain't Destiny's Child, nigga. Don't say no names.
Okay.
I'm say my name as Fed, working ass nigga, man.
Man, you know, we had people that listen to our show, man. And shout outs to all the people that listen to our show, man. We have people that listen to our show, man.
Don't make
males
me put analytics, females, man. We worldwide in this bitch.
I've told
Jerusalem.
I've told
Pakistan.
Several people that I'm a worldwide blogger.
Croatia.
Man, look.
I got the analytics to
man,
prove
it. I be saying it, but they don't. And man, shout out to everybody that's listening to the show. Segue. We do have 16 shots shirts and 2530 media shots, 3025 media shirts.
As you can see, he's getting drunk, folks.
Yeah. Available.
We got some merch, man. It's going to be up on the website. You niggas go check out the website. I can see how many people come to the website. I'm trying to get some more traffic, man.
What's the website?
Yeah. It's in the description.
I know.
Man. You're asking me questions.
I know.
Yeah.
But
check out the description.
Yeah,
of the pod,
man.
Guys.
Go to.
There will be a link inside the description of the pod.
Yes. Go to the pod and also go to the IG and the Facebook.
It's all 16 Shots Podcast on IG, Twitter, Facebook.
Go to the
link tree.
If you have Tidal, there's a 16 Shots playlist of all the songs we played on the show.
Oh, you've done that.
I've done that.
I don't fuck with Tidal.
Okay, well, don't fuck with Tidal, man.
But I'm a fuck with it, though.
Yeah. What was that? Summertime.
What's going on with summertime? Man. Is summertime even going to be open? I mean, it's Texas, so it was open last summer, to be honest with you.
No, it wasn't.
Man, I was out here in these streets. I was in these streets.
I was too, man. Texas was closed.
Texas wasn't closed.
It was closed more like...
Texas wasn't closed because everybody was coming to Texas to go to clubs.
I mean, I don't club, son.
We don't either. I don't either, but I'm saying, that's why I'm saying, like, Texas wasn't closed.
It's a married man talking. He said, we don't either. The married...
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Congratulations,
I don't
man.
Streets, man. You almost there, huh? What's the name?
Say, man.
Talk about your queen.
The Rockets. The Rockets.
Nah, talk about your queen,
man.
My guy. You know what I'm saying? Shout out. What's her name?
The Rockets, man.
What's their names?
What are you... Man, see, man, he does this on purpose, man, to put me in spots. But like I said, summertime. And when you was a teen, man, what was your summer like, man? Explain to me a summer day.
What age?
15 years. 15 years old.
A-Dub.
Ninth grade A-Dub summertime. Speak on it.
Ninth grade A-Dub was working at Astro World and Water World. That was my summer, working at Astro World and Water World, going to the teen club with my partners.
Mm-hmm. Which one you went to?
The one on South Main, I forgot the name of it.
And
before then, we would out hit up Stadium Bowl for the closing
down.
Stadium
Bowl, man.
Yeah. But nah, A-Dub always had a job because A-Dub wanted money.
Okay.
So we was trapping out of that Astro World and Water World, you know what I'm talking about? And then they closed it down. But before then, you know, my summers would be filled with seeing out of little females from school.
Yeah.
You know, at the mall, or then you would hit up Astro World. You know what I'm talking about? And then try to get numbers doing Fright Fest, even though that's the end of the summer.
Fright Fest, man.
Yeah, bro, that was pretty fire.
Astro-Rail, man.
Your
days
are numbered, my nigga.
Look, bro.
Your days are numbered. It's counting down. We in like the single, like five. Just counting.
See how I hit you with the gong, man?
Days are numbered with this soundboard.
I just gonged you, bro. I just gonged you. But, Man, so I grew up in I almost said a real hood. But I ain't, you know what I'm saying?
What you mean? You trying to say the Clark ain't a real hood?
I apologize, bro. The the great American poet William Dennis said, "Your hood ain't no harder than mine." So I grew up in my neighborhood. It was just like yours. We had houses, apartments, all that kind of stuff. So myself, Ronald Williams.
Oh, you talking about the tray? I thought you was talking about Uganda and your village.
myself, Ronald Williams, Lawrence Franklin, Lacey Berry.
You a name dropping? Yeah, I'm a name
dropper. You know what I'm saying? Because it's been an issue about my tray affiliations, man. And like I'll be feeling some kind of way, man, because I'll be like, look, man, I don't even know dudes' street names. I know they real names, you know what I'm saying? But myself.
So you bringing up beef with the OG again.
Man, I love everybody, man. So myself, Ron Williams, Lawrence Franklin, Lacey Berry, we stayed on a 2800 block of Wichita. And so our parents got together and was like, look, you know, RIP Lacey mom. But our parents got together and they were like, look, our boys are always together. So as long as they're together, we know they're gonna take care of each other, right? So it was like they knew either we were at somebody's house or we were together. So we pretty much had like, you know, we had the run of we could do whatever we want to as long as they knew we were together, right? So in the summertime, it was like, y'all just be together. So we was together, man, and we explored the entire neighborhood. We explored every inch of the neighborhood, which means going to TSU, sneaking in, shooting jumpers, which means going to Rice and playing at Rice, which means going to the South Central YMCA, being at Yates, TSU, you know.
Do kids still like roam the streets in the summertime?
I don't know, bro. I'm in my 40s, bro.
Cause we used to like pack up in one car.
A car?
Yeah.
A car.
We used to pack up in one car and just go ride, bro. Go from one hood to the next. I am from the clock though, you know.
Yeah, y'all kind of far. So I mean, we used to have street battles. So every street, you know what I'm saying, had every street was okay, you Wichita, you Cleburne, Blodgett, whatever street you are, that's your street, right? That you live on. And so we would meet at locations and we have basketball games, football games, baseball games, and that was like, you know, and every street had at least five people. Wentworth, you know, from Calumet all the way to shit, all through the tray. So we would meet up, you know, at different spots at different times, you know what I mean? Sometimes it would be cool. We would play the game. We'd lose or win and be happy sometimes. Middle of the game, it'd be a fight, you know what I'm saying? Whatever, you know what I mean? Shit. That was my growing up, you know what I'm saying? And then, of course, as you get older, you know, some people who were athletes turned into super athletes. People turned into drug dealers. People turned into nerds. People turned into, you know, hustlers, whatever. But at the end of the day, we all knew each other in an intimate setting, like knowing like, okay, this guy right here, he's left-handed. This guy right here, he's strong. This guy right here, he's fast. This guy right here, he doesn't like contact. This guy over here, you know, we all knew each other. So this guy right here, he's gay. This guy, you know, whatever it was, we knew each other. So now at 25 and 30 and 40, we don't trip on each other. Like, I know you, you know me. You know what I'm saying? I know you might have went off and did this, but I know you growing up. I know you coming up in the summertime. You know what I mean? So it's like the summer was a time when everybody kind of learned each other. You know what I mean? And then you go to school and like, okay, we in school now. But in the summertime, I know that she likes tall guys or she does this or he does. We know each other from the summertime. So
my summertime when I was younger was full of activities. I always had something going on.
Oh, man.
So I always was like some sort of like summer sports program.
Man.
I ain't had time to fuck off. I didn't start fucking off until I got in high school, and I really moved around how I wanted to. Mm-hmm. Smoked on the side of the high, shit like that.
Shit. And several times, man, NYSP.
I don't know what that is.
That's God, what is it? It's, I forgot what N is, but youth sports program. I was in youth sports program. It was at TSU. You pretty basically had 150 kids that got to either stay on campus for the whole time. And man, it was wonderful.
I never did nothing like that.
And then you had, of course, you had the YMCA.
I never went to the Y. My first experience with the Y was working there, bro.
Oh, man. Shout out to King Head. You know what I'm saying? Man, I grew up in the Y.
No, I ain't grew up in the Y.
I grew up like going to
the
program.
I ain't know what that was.
When I see kids in the Y, as a counselor, like it was 100 days, maybe 200 days when I walk in, I'm like, man.
But see, when I was younger, mm-hmm. First off, there was no YMCA in the Clark.
That's one?
The closest right. YMCA was on Sterling Link, and we ain't go to Bella. Yeah. Where's you? And the other piece is, like, I spent a lot of time, when I was younger, I spent a lot of time with my grandfather, bro.
Okay.
So, in that aspect, my summers were filled with just chilling with my grandfather and his homies. So, I used to just sit there and just soak up game, bro, because they sat there, bro. I used to want to be a pimp or a man of leisure.
Brother.
Because I thought that's what they were, because they just sat there, you know what I'm saying? They was all, like, well-dressed gentlemen, you know what I'm saying? Man. Silk shirts,
let me tell you,
wing tip shoes, gold in their mouth, and they had like one or two Link medallions on. And them boys smoked cigarettes, and then they talked about life, and then they'd be like, "Yeah, you learn about these broads when you get older,
bruh."
You know what I'm saying?
Let me tell you about. Okay, not to take any of the shine off of what you're saying, but let me tell you about summers at the Y, South Central YMCA.
I hate the Y, but go ahead, go.
So, South Central YMCA, the Kappa League, the Kappa Basketball League was started there. Mm-hmm. They had a league where they basically the Kappas came in and was like, shit, we want these kids to have something to do for the summer. We're going to sponsor the whole league. All y'all got to do is come. So, 100, 200 kids come, y'all work out for 30 minutes. We're going to have a draft and play games. That's just one part of it. Okay. At the Y was that the Globetrotters had tryouts there.
The South Central Y was a different dynamic though. Hey, it was so close to TSU.
Hey, it was across the street from TSU. That's what I'm saying. Across the street from U of H.
That's what I'm saying.
All right.
The location was fire.
Boy. Okay, so we got the Globetrotters there. So one of my coaches was a joke growing up. I'm working out with Reggie Dixon, one of the Globetrotters. You know what I'm saying? Okay. Then on top of that, Yates is right there. Yates is across the street from the Y. So I got
that's the winkiest, leakiest story to Yates.
Boy, man, I'm not even a lion, but I ain't gonna look, man. You ain't never seen Johnny Bailey get a kickoff.
I have. What you talking about?
You know, if you watch Johnny Bailey get a kickoff.
Johnny Bailey's greatness and Yates. Johnny Bailey was great, nigga, not Yates.
Robert, what about Big Rue?
The single niggas is great, not Yates, nigga.
Yeah, okay, I'm just saying.
Nigga, you know, fuck them JY niggas.
Oh, man. See, man.
Fuck y'all in y'all line, nigga. See, I'm Harry Clark, nigga. Fuck y'all.
My reformness is going to keep. But.
JY ass nigga, man.
So summertime,
you JY niggas, don't try to run up on me in the streets, bro.
So summertime was so filled with just camaraderie. You know what I'm saying? Stephen Gaines, man, Stephen Gaines, bro, he taught us how to be brothers. Like he literally taught us like how to be brothers. Like, look, nah, you don't do that. You do this. This is how you treat your brother. This is how, like, I don't know if I know he did. But he done pulled me to the side 100 times and gave me some real, like, look, man, XYZ, man, he don't read good. So he gonna have to play sports. You read well and you can play sports. So anytime you see him not reading well, you hop in and you help him. You know what I mean?
So let me ask you a question. In that aspect,
yeah,
he's already good at sports.
Yeah.
But he doesn't read well.
Yeah.
So shouldn't he probably be working on his reading instead of dribbling the basketball?
But the thing is that when him dribbling the basketball, he like there are people who you know they're gonna play sports. They have a God-given gift to play baseball, basketball, soccer, tennis, whatever.
Correct. It is. But it's but that only gets you so far.
What you say it slowly. It gets you how far? What you mean?
I said that only gets you so far.
Like so far, like what?
What you mean, like what?
Like to get $1 million contract?
Let's keep it a bean though.
Give it a bean.
Not the $1 million contract outcome
is
not is that's not a. It's more of the exception than the rule.
But you not hear what I'm saying. I'm going to go back to Third Ward and Yates. Third Ward and Yates got 17, 20, 30 people coming. Felicia Rashad went to Yates. Bailey, Zantana Dotson, Big Rule. I can name Patrick Swayze went to Yates.
But let's be honest. Out of the, for every Johnny Bailey.
Yeah.
That made it.
Yeah.
It's 10, 20 niggas in the hood everywhere. And just in Houston.
In Houston.
It's 10, 20 niggas in Houston.
Yeah.
That were colder than Johnny Bailey and didn't make it.
I don't know about colder. I'm not going to say that.
What you mean? It's niggas who was colder than Jordan or colder than LeBron that didn't make it.
I don't believe so. I disagree.
What I'm saying is, if I got a kid.
Yeah.
And I'm not taking anything away from your mentor you're speaking of. I'm just saying, in general, sometimes we put a premium on the wrong thing.
No, but you know what I'm saying? What I was saying was, like I said, by brotherhood. If I'm in a room with my brother and he has a problem with something,
mm-hmm.
I don't make jokes. I don't laugh. I help him out. And if I know my brother can't do something, before we even get to that point, I'm pulling his coattail. Hey, you want to go over here and work on this reading?
Y'all have definitely laughed at me while helping me out, though.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, y'all have definitely laughed at me while
but we,
helping
but
me
we
out.
Still helped you out, though.
Yeah, but y'all laughed.
You know what I'm
from
saying?
From a good, healthy place.
Well, I'm saying a healthy laugh. I'm saying, like, we don't ridicule to the point, like we laughed amongst us.
No, we've definitely ridiculed each other first. And it, then
yeah, we laughed amongst us.
Yeah.
Well, I'm saying, like, we go in a room and it's 20 of us and my brother's fucking up or my brother's having a problem.
Yeah.
I'm jumping in and not jumping in. I was like, leave him alone. But I know my brother who can read, who can't read. Don't even bother him. Who want to read? I read.
But that's what I'm saying. My question is this.
Mm-hmm.
And tell me if I'm wrong. If I know I got a kid.
Yeah.
They can dunk the shit out of the basketball at age 13.
Mm-hmm.
But homie really, you know, can't read that well.
Mm-hmm.
Shouldn't I put a little bit more into helping him read more
than
his athletic prowess?
You should, but what I'm saying is, because you, Aaron W., you care about him. You want him to be a complete person, right?
Well, because I know that making it to the league,
yeah,
that's like the 1%.
Yeah, but you care about him, though. You care enough about him to be like, man, this league thing is percentage. But the other piece, the other parties that see him, the high school coach, the middle school coach, the AU coach, they just see, oh, I got a product.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna exploit him.
Yeah.
So the brothers be coming through like, nah, you're not using my brother like that. And if you do want to use him like that, I'm gonna help my brother to get better. I'm gonna be the one to be like, hey, whatever I gotta do, man, like, bruh, I don't know if this is your experience, but when I was at the Y, we used to have high school coaches come to our games. Like, the way we used to refer on each other is like, what a bag you got? Oh, I got Milby, I got Austin. Like, what schools' bags or outfits or hats do you have? Because they couldn't give you apparel, gear, you know what I mean? They was coming, give them gear. Oh, here's a backpack. Here's a so-and-so. Here's a so-and-so. Here's a so-and-so. Because it was like, we had we had talent, because back then they used to rank the wives by talent. They'd be like, this is, you know, so and so why I had was number one, so and so. We were number one why in talent every year. So they would literally come to our games. You come to our games, it'd be parents and it'd be coaches. And the high school coaches was like, oh, what school are you going to? You know, so in 94, 5, 6, 7, you had a bunch of kids who were all from the same area, going to every school in HISD, whether it be Milby, Yates, Madison, Sam Houston, Jones. You know, it's like, oh, that's Mike. That's so-and-so. That's Leonard Ray. That's Eddie Barlow. You know, that's so-and-so, so-and-so. They all over the league because they came and scooped us up. You know what I mean? But even in that essence, if I see, like right now today, if I see Eddie Barlow, if I see Leonard Ray, if I see Mike Staley, if I see any of these guys, it's like shit. It's love because if I see Nevels, it's love because we came up together as brothers in that situation. We're brothers first, and that's from Steve Gaines. You know what I'm saying?
I got you. Hey, before you leave, pick a bottom name you dropped. Nah, that's fire, yeah. Bro. And I missed that. I didn't have that experience, bro. Yeah. I didn't go to the Y. Like, yeah. I said, it really wasn't no Y in the Clark.
In every Y, like, I'm saying, and even to expound that, going to other Ys, every Y ain't like that.
It's not.
You know what I'm saying? We had Mr. Stovall. I'm dropping more names. Mr. Stovall, who was a council member, he made it. He empowered Mr. Gaines to give us that opportunity.
Hey, man, you know what was cool when I started working at the Y? I went with Stovall. We went on a freedom tour, bro.
Yeah.
And I went on a freedom tour.
He was in Alabama, all that shit.
And I said that, and I'm on a freedom tour as an adult.
Yeah.
And I'm soaking up all this shit, bro. And I'm like, damn, like, this is an experience that every teenager, especially a black kid, should actually go on. And they didn't, a lot of them didn't even take that experience and embrace it how they should. It was kind of like, oh, I left Texas. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's hard.
But it was fire. It was fire, bro. It was just cool to hit up all these places, to actually see the tomb of Martin Luther King, go to the hotel where he got shot, see the church that he preached in, see some other historical spots.
Are you familiar what happened when his death?
When he died?
Yeah.
I've heard two things.
What have you heard?
So I've heard that he got shot, and he ultimately died in the hospital.
Yeah.
Which we know that happened.
Yeah.
And then I also heard, like, he was smothered to death for real.
Yeah.
The doctor spit in his face, that he really made it through the surgery and made it through the assassination attempt and was actually killed in the hospital.
Yeah.
So I've heard that too.
Yeah. That's part,
And I'm not sure how accurate it is. I know Judge Joe Brown runs around and he says a couple of things regarding the assassination of Dr. King and some other stuff. I don't know how accurate Judge Joe Brown is, because it would put him in his early or mid-20s if he really did do all of these things as a lawyer. So I don't know how true it is.
I mean, I wouldn't
I'm not say, doubting him.
Yeah, like that's the thing about racism. Like, racism is so random and nonsensical. It's like, why do you hate me so much?
Same thing with Malcolm, though. Hey, did you ever
Malcolm got killed. He died there.
No, I know that, but I'm just saying, like, surrounding him being killed, like, did you see the doc that was on Netflix? And this is some shit I didn't know. Like, growing up, I was taught about Malcolm. You know, you get taught all the stuff by any means necessary. Mm-hmm. Everybody sees the picture of Malcolm standing at the window with the rifle.
Mm-hmm.
We know his teaching. Like, growing up in a household as Christian, we were glued to the TV when Farrakhan spoke. And knowing that Farrakhan was up under Malcolm and being able to hear some of the speeches that he spoke about, I saw this doc and I didn't realize.
Are you talking about the one with about the doc about the mosque that supposedly killed
In Jersey?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. Watching that doc, I didn't, growing up and just being, growing up not being Muslim, I didn't understand how much money really was involved with the nation at the time. And to see the doc and how Malcolm was the mouthpiece for the nation and how Elijah Muhammad was able to recruit these guys. And they loved Elijah Muhammad. But Malcolm X was kind of like, he took the nation to the next level. He was able to captivate the audience and really move a crowd. He was able to move a crowd in ways that Elijah Muhammad couldn't move a crowd. And by looking at the doc, it kind of looks like some jealousy was involved with not only Elijah Muhammad, but some of his sons. And it looked like Malcolm wasn't falling in line with what they really wanted him to say. And I didn't realize how deep, you know, the Muslim faith was, especially in Jersey. I got a boy from Jersey.
Yeah.
And as I was watching this doc, I'm like, damn, I didn't know it was like that. And I asked him, I'm like, bro, you from Jersey? Like, you're not Muslim. And he was like, nah, but pretty much in Jersey, everybody Muslim. And if you're not, like, pretty much everybody Muslim. And if you ain't Muslim, your cousin Muslim, your daddy Muslim. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. And I didn't realize it was that deep. And just to see how this one guy probably killed Malcolm, got away with it, and then just lived his life as this respectable guy in the community. I don't know what was up with all these guys dying their beards red. Like, I didn't know what that was about.
Yeah.
I want to know why that's a thing. I know, you know, like the beard thing. I know why, you know, the Muslim guys grow beards or whatever.
So what's your thing with the beard?
It has something to do with, like, not cutting your hair or your beard.
It's defiance. Beard.
Oh, that's what it is. Yeah, see, I didn't know. A guy started, like, quoting scripture to me about, thou shall not trim the curves of this and that.
Beard signifies defiance, man. Beard,
oh, yeah?
Yeah. That's why, if you've noticed, if you look in history, as far as European history, they don't have beards because the clean cut is conformity.
I don't trust a nigga with no face hair.
Me either.
Back in the day, it was frowned upon if you were a businessman and you didn't have face hair, because then you was a bald face liar. Like, that's where that whole bald face liar come from. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So
I agree with you, man.
Yeah, I don't trust a nigga with no face hair.
I think I don't trust him, man. But I'm like,
I don't, because if you some bad decisions, if you're an old nigga with gray hair and you ain't got no face hair, you trying to talk to young hoes, and I feel like you trying to talk like underage hoes. I mean, females. I'm trying to stop calling.
Don't call them hoes. Hoes, hoes.
Yeah. So, that was pretty cool. So any listeners, if y'all know why a lot of the New Jersey Muslims dye their beards red, let me know. What you got next on the docket?
What's your plan for tonight? I mean, not tonight, but I mean, because we've already scratched the surface on certain things. You know what I'm saying? And
We almost tapped out for the night, bro.
Right. Okay, so
I mean, you know, we do three pots a week. We can save some of this content, bro. Yeah. Because we got content on content on content.
All right, I'm gonna skip then.
Before we get out of here, we gotta talk about.
We're going out. I don't want to talk about the three. I want to talk about two.
I'm following your lead. Go to four. Okay. I'm just saying, before we get out of here, we got to talk about Invincible.
Okay. Oh, you got it? Yeah. Okay.
I got some takes, and I don't know if they're going to be as popular as yours. Or...
All right. So I'm going to talk about polyamorous lifestyles.
Hey.
Okay, so could you do a polyamorous relationship?
Nah, I don't want to. So.
You couldn't share?
It sounds good on the surface.
Yeah.
Me having two other, you know, me plus my wife was a girl, or another wife or two.
I mean, it could be you.
And it could be me.
And you.
It could be sister, brother husbands.
It could be me and you and somebody else.
It could be brother husbands.
I don't want to have nothing with your wife. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying.
Is that really a thing, though, to, like, do some women have multiple husbands? I always thought it was the other way around. I thought it was like the dude had like multiple wives.
It goes every which way, bro.
It can. Some people think it's just a big orgy.
Okay. But as the questions I'm asking, what do you think about it? How do you feel about polyamorous relationships?
On the surface, when you first just speak about it,
yeah,
it sounds fire.
Yeah.
You need to tell me I can have like three wives and then so I can just hit each one of them every other night. But I don't need three females sitting at the eating table just discussing me while I'm at work. You know what I'm saying? Because then I feel like they're going to all get on the same page. I don't need to walk in the house to three mean mugs.
Three at the same time?
Because it's bad if you can't get none from three women just mad at you. Because, you know, you might have said the wrong thing to just one. Oh, so you said that to her? I don't like that either.
Yeah, what?
Yeah. So I think it's more of a headache because it's not just a sexual thing, bro. You got to be able to support them financially. You got to be able to support them physically. You got to be able to support them mentally. Yeah, you like it ain't just a sex thing, bro. You got to be able to be like, and that's what some of these brothers
don't understand.
Like, you got to be there emotionally and mentally for them too.
So, question: if you would rate sex on the scale in a relationship, what is the percentage of importance of sex in a relationship? How do you feel? I'm not saying that your answer is the right answer.
Right.
How do you feel about it?
I think if you're with someone you truly love,
yeah,
y'all are emotionally connected.
Okay.
It's the right person for you to be with. Yeah. Like, y'all are friends first.
Yeah.
Sex is probably middle of the road.
So 30%? Hold on. What's the percentage of, the importance? Is it 20, 30, 40, 50?
Middle of the road.
At 50%?
I don't think it's 50%.
You said middle of the road. I'm trying to ask my number.
All right. And it's probably lower than that.
It's 30. 30% is sex?
30.
So how much is mental?
90.
No, that's 120. I can count.
What you mean?
If you said sex is 30,
yeah,
and then mental is 90, that's 120%.
Look, man, anybody tell you to be a mathematician? I'm just telling you that the mental, emotional aspect.
Yeah. It's 100% of anything.
I'm just saying the mental and emotional aspect of the situation, it's more important than the sex. Because to be honest with you, you can fuck anybody. So you can get a nut from anybody. So who you getting a nut from don't matter. It matters if you are mentally and emotionally connected and equally yoked, as they like to say. The money don't matter. Sex don't matter. The physical don't matter. Because that shit can come and go. Because you can be, it's easy to be with somebody when the sex is good and they got a bunch of money. What happens when they get broke?
I mean, you can be broke and have good sex, though.
But what happens when you get broke and you don't want to fuck because you broke?
Man. See.
See, I don't know about you.
Oh, so I'm not trying to cause any problems.
No,
I'm
saying
what
I'm saying is, I don't know
my
about
dick
you.
And my wallets aren't attached.
Nah, nigga, when I'm broke, I don't like it. I'm upset, bro. Nigga, when I'm broke, I'm pissed. The world ain't right, bro. If I can't do the simple shit, if I can't make no bread,
what's
if
that
I ain't
time
got
you
no
broke,
money,
man?
Huh?
That's time you. What's the last time you been broke?
I'm broke, broke. I'm broke every day. What are you talking about?
Nah, see, I don't try to front for the cameras, man.
There ain't no cameras on.
What's the last time you been broke?
I'm broke, broke.
No. What's the last time you been broke?
What'd you consider broke?
Broke is when like you can't get a meal.
Oh man, I'm not gonna be that broke. I'm always gonna figure it out.
What's the last time I've been broke? I couldn't get a meal. It's been a while.
But what I'm saying is you have periods of time where, shit, nigga, I got $10 in the bank, if that. You know what I'm saying? I don't like that.
What's the last time you had?
I don't
had,
function
hold
well
up.
If I,
What's
if
the
I'm
last time you had less than $100 in your bank?
Shit. Oh.
Before COVID.
I mean, it's been spurts. I've been laid off before in the last 8 years, at least twice.
Man, the cold part about being laid off is that, I mean... Okay, so we live in a country that's run by big business, right? And so the logical move is to be in the cog or be a cog in the machine of big business. But then once you do that, you have to know that big business can get rid of you at any time, right? Okay. So it's like work to get in big business, but then big business can be like, shit, we don't want this department no more.
Okay.
And so now you kind of ass out.
And you figure it out.
Yeah. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about us. As like for me, I started off with the Y. And I was like, shit, the Y working and it's fucking with me. It's doing, but then like I do A and they're like, shit, you did this one thing. Fuck this 27 things you did that made us an extra half a million. This one thing that cost us 20,000, not even 20,000, it cost us some grief. We're going to put you in the mix. And so I realized that I was like, damn, I could do all this shit, but y'all going to judge me by this other shit.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like the entire dynamic is volatile. You know what I mean? So at the end of the day, like, I'd rather try to have as much control as I can have over what I'm doing, as opposed to putting it in the hands of somebody else.
I mean, that's why I feel like you probably gotta put some away. So you can't spend every dollar you get.
Yeah.
You gotta put some away.
Yeah.
Cause you never know when you can get laid off.
Yeah.
And you also gotta try to have some multiple streams of income.
Yeah.
Now I'm not like some of these YouTube niggas who, oh man, you're stupid if you ain't got multiple streams of income.
Yeah.
This shit ain't as easy as them trying to make it seem.
It's very difficult.
Yeah, but if you can get a nest egg, or you can figure out how to have another stream of income coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Like COVID, the last year, bro, this COVID shit, it kind of made me realize some things. I was like, damn, I'm forced to go out here. Regardless of how I truly felt about the COVID shit,
yeah,
I was forced to still get up and go out and be an essential worker with no essential pay. You dig?
Yeah.
And I was like, damn, I don't have no other streams of income coming in. You know, if I get laid off today for this COVID shit, I'd be all right because I have a low overhead. But I didn't have the multiple streams of income I wanted to have coming in.
Yeah.
And I was forced in a certain aspect to maintain the lifestyle that I live to go out. So I said, I'm not doing that again. And I started doing a couple of things to add a couple of streams of income in the event that this happens again.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be like, yeah, fuck y'all. I'm gonna go ahead and stay inside because,
yeah,
you know, I can maintain. Because everybody can't be a boss. If everybody is owning their own business and being a boss at the same time, there will be no consumers or any workers for said businesses. So everybody can strive to be a boss, and you can eventually be your own boss and own your own company. But there's something to working, getting experience too. You know what I'm saying? And everybody ain't built to be a boss or a CEO. Everybody ain't built to do that. Some people are built to work. Some people are worker bees. Some people are in charge.
I agree.
You got to know your strengths.
My thing is that in accordance and agreeing with you saying, everybody in the boss, and everybody doesn't want their responsibility.
Everybody don't want their responsibility.
You know what I mean? And that's okay. It's cool. But you have to accept your station. Like, if I want to be a middle management, then I have to accept that station. I can't give middle management effort and want upper management pay.
You got to work at what you want.
No, but I'm saying, yeah, I can't give entry level effort and want higher tier pay.
You gotta be realistic. So if you're in the workplace,
yeah.
Like prime example, what I actually do for a living, I got into it because I wanted my own dealership to do these things. And once I started working within the business, I realized I don't want that headache.
Mm-hmm.
I'm cool with doing what I'm doing. As long as I have growth opportunities, which I have growth opportunities to a certain aspect. Some of it is still bullshit. some of it is still spinning my wheels, but I do have goals I'm working towards.
Okay.
And if I see I can, if I see I've gotten as far as I can get with where I'm at, then I'll even go somewhere else. Cause I don't think we don't live in that age like my father's age and my grandfather's age, where you loyal to a corporation or a company and you work there until you retire. Like my old man bust his ass, retired, got like a gold Rolex or some shit.
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't even worth what a Rolex would be worth, cause they want to put the company logo on the face instead of just giving you the Rolly.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So the Rolly that he could have just flipped for 10 bands ain't worth nothing but $3,500. Cause whoever buy it got to switch out the logo on the face.
Mm-hmm.
You dig? Niggas don't do that no more. Like, if this shit don't work for me in 2 to 3, I'm out. I'm gonna go somewhere else. So it's just how you use it. It's just a tool, man. But everybody ain't built to be a boss, man. Everybody ain't built to have their own business. Everybody don't want to deal with, like everybody don't want to deal with the fact that I can work as hard as I work and I can walk away with 10 bands this week. Mm-hmm. Some people think I can own my own business, then I ain't got to work. I can just show up when I want to show up, go on vacation all the time, and I'm still going to make the money. And that ain't how it work.
No. Like, I think that we as a people, as a culture, we've never really understood how money works.
Oh, I don't think it's just us. I think
I'm not talking about hip hop. I'm talking about as an American culture.
Oh, exactly. It's only a 1% of American culture who really know how money works.
Yeah.
And I think everybody else spinning their wheels trying to live the American dream.
Mm-hmm. We don't know what wealth is.
No, we don't.
We don't know what like people say things like generational wealth, and they don't know what that means.
They don't. People think they're wealthy because they can go buy $400,000 house and a Benz,
mm-hmm.
and a boat and a yacht,
mm-hmm.
and be up to their eyeballs in debt, and they whole paycheck gone by paying off all this shit, but they feel like that's like the American dream.
Mm-hmm.
Nah, I won't fuck you money. That's generational wealth to me. Generational wealth is when you make so much money, mm-hmm. where 4 generations behind you really ain't got to do shit.
Mm.
That's generational wealth.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? But
I agree. I totally agree, man.
I won't fuck. I'm trying to get fuck you money, bro.
I mean, yeah.
Like, fuck you. Like when you say, hey, no, fuck you. Get into my Bentley.
But then in the same breath, like, it's, what you're talking about is the fuck you money is not necessarily an amount, but it's about my lifestyle.
Exactly. It's about I don't have to be here and deal with this bullshit you got going on.
Exactly. Exactly. So I'm saying, because like people want to put a number on it, like I got to have 40,000 or 70,000 or.
It was making that noise.
Oh.
Yeah, that feedback.
I mean, I could take it out, man.
I just unplugged it right now.
I got it. Cause see, normally how we do it is like I get the first song, you get the last song,
mm-hmm.
and so if you get the first song, the last song, you know what I'm saying?
I don't know about that.
No, I got a song that I really want to make it work. You know what I'm saying?
I'm editing it out.
Why you gotta write my song out, man?
Cause those songs be trash,
man, bruh. 16 shots. Podcast on Tidal.
I don't think that's a thing, bro.
It is a thing. Mm. It's there. I can look at it. I can pull it up. It's valuable.
Is it B Dot approved?
Who the fuck is B Dot?
Ain't that the nigga that the editor nigga B Dot?
B Dot. I know B Dot graphics, but I don't know who to.
Never mind, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
What's up next? We gotta talk about Invincible, bro.
Hey, okay.
And we're reaching 2 hours, so we got to talk about Invincible.
We're talking about it for like 2 minutes, no, 3 minutes. I'm going to put a timer on, 3 minutes.
Why, you got so much you want to talk about?
No, nothing else. Invincible.
Invincible is it, and then we're out, bitch.
So, seeing the final episode of Invincible, what was your thoughts?
All right, so seeing the final episode of Invincible,
yeah.
I thought it was going to be a bigger plot twist.
Yeah.
than what it was, because you was kind of hyping it up.
Yeah.
Like it was going to be some crazy shit.
I mean, I thought it was
crazy. It wasn't that crazy.
It was crazy.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
But Omni-Man pretty much was just like, I am from an alien planet.
Yeah.
But I lied. You know, we really
take over this shit.
Take over planets.
Yeah.
You know,
so really, the whole plot twist is like, yeah, I'm Superman, but I ain't Superman for them.
I'm Superman
for them.
If you want, man, Omni-Man a real nigga.
He's a real nigga.
Man, Omni-Man a real nigga.
Why?
Because he's loyal to his people.
Okay, keep going.
He's loyal to his people, bro.
His people is fucked up, though.
Is his people really fucked up?
Yeah, like, we don't come to protect the planet.
That's not true.
We come to take him over.
Taking over and protecting, it all depends on what side of the fence you're on. Because yeah, okay. Omni-Man is saying, look, bro, y'all, Earth mm-hmm. needs to join the Federation.
Mm-hmm.
Because we can bring life-changing technology to Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Advancements in healthcare that can extend lives.
Mm-hmm.
Technology to make the life quality better.
Mm-hmm.
All y'all got to do is join.
Mm-hmm.
So people like Omni-Man, people like Thanos, their intentions are pure. Now, it's how they choose to do it, which is fucked up.
Exactly.
Now, all Omni-Man really did was kill the protectors of Earth. That's all he did, bro.
Why gotta kill him, though?
He didn't have to kill him, but he knew they weren't gonna accept what he was gonna tell them.
Because it's some bullshit. If I gotta kill you.
He didn't have to kill him.
He had to kill him.
He didn't have to
he
kill
had
him.
To. Yes, he didn't have to. He had to.
Omni-Man could have sat down
and
told him what was.
But they wouldn't agree with the shit.
He could kill him anyway.
No, but I'm saying he killed them because he already knew, like, if I tell y'all this shit, y'all not going for this.
This is my thing.
Okay, keep going.
I can at least tell you first. And I can give you the option of getting down and not getting down.
Yeah.
And if you don't get down, you need to get down and lay down.
Yeah.
And so, you know, he ain't have to summon them all in one spot and then just fuck them up.
Yeah, that was fucked up.
He could have summoned them then and just talked about it.
Yeah.
He a real nigga, bro. But he ain't have to beat the shit out of son.
He beat the
dog shit. But he didn't kill him.
He wanted to kill him.
He wanted to out of loyalty to his people. But then he was like, damn, that's my son.
Yeah.
Even though your mom was like a pet to me.
He beat his son to like.
And then just left because he was pissed off.
He wanted to kill his son, but he's like, it's my son. I can't kill
really, him. He bought his son some more time because they're going to come back and fuck Earth up.
Who?
I feel like they're going to come back, bro.
I need you to just read the comics.
Do they come back?
I need you to read the comics, man.
I'm going to fuck with the comics, but I just feel like his son a little bit of a bitch, too, though.
Nah, his son was going hard, man. His son was like. Through the whole series.
This nigga almost died like 3 times.
Yeah. And he never quit though.
Well, no. Well, that part about it, no, but.
And then he was like, he knew he couldn't beat his dad. But he's like, I'm gonna go hard. It's like his dad was like, fuck Earth. He was like, nah, fuck you, man.
Alright, but see, this is the other piece. Yeah. And I'm loyal to my old man to a fault.
Okay.
I'm probably gonna rob my old man. I'll be like, hey, yeah, man, fuck Earth. Let's go get mama. Cause if you look at it, he really on some real shit, Omni-Man won't finna fuck over his wife and his kid. And honestly, I think Omni-Man was on some like, look, I'm really looking out for Earth. I like you Earthlings.
Yeah.
So I don't think it would have been a bad outcome. I think he fucked up who he needed to fuck up. Cecil definitely was gonna get it. But
the whole thing is that Omni-Man wanted Earth to be subservient. And that shit like, nah, man, we can't be subservient. We can work together, but it's subservient? Nah.
They never was given an option, though. Like, then that conversation never happened. But his race of people are like tryhards. So exactly. It ain't going to be no working it out. Nigga, you niggas going to bow. Bow, niggas. Bow.
Mm-mm.
Essentially, his planet was America, and Earth was like Mexico.
Yeah. I guess, man.
I don't think it was as bad as it was. So we have a friend of the show who would like to come on and take a deep dive in them.
I haven't seen them.
You gotta watch on Amazon Prime.
How many episodes?
It's some black suffrage.
How many episodes is it?
It's probably about 8.
I can watch it. I'll watch it.
So I'm gonna finish watching. I stopped because there was too much black suffrage going on, but you know, he wanna talk about it, so we're gonna talk about it.
I'm with you.
All right, so we finna get out of here. So I guess I gotta plug the ox back up.
Yeah, man, I got something for you.
And let you play your little bitch ass song. I mean, you know, it's a little bitch ass song. I mean, you know, you technically ain't gotta play it like right away. I can do the salutations and then we can throw
thing,
it on.
Man. It ain't plugged in, so do your thing, man.
So you know what I'm talking about. It is what it is. So, 16 Shots Podcast with one young James Boogie. Bow. I am AR Dub.
Bow.
And we out.
Here you are standing. Sugar Daddy Slim, baby. Like talk to you. So work out some things. Fat waist snatch, damn, look at that. Prada bucket hat with them Prada boots to match. Hershey got her OnlyFans, I'ma support your queen. Had to her ass be like damn when she hit the scene. Attitude rude, now she don't want you, dude. Only thing will make her smile is a good plate of food. Steak 48 in Houston is my weekly stops. Races for brunches, swirl mimosas, yeah, that hit the spot. Let's pick a drop when it's hot and hit a couple blocks. I can show you new things if you just ride and watch. Watch out for haters, I got many cause they can't compete. Let's level up and leave them, make them all obsolete. Dior her, don't bore her, and she'll act right. I ain't God, baby, but I'm trying to bless your life. She keep me smiling, so she smiling, shit, it's only fair. Plus, when you getting this kind of paper, you don't really care. And she share, find friends out to come visit. I'm trying to do it big, like the homie, help the dick.
I ain't never wanted you to stay.
And she with it, stay ready, setting up the plate. She love when the boss live life the boss way. Here to stay, so real and cook a mean meal. They don't make them like this no more, you gotta see her. When she say she wanna play, I say you got a deal. Been a few years and she still ain't switch on me still.